Hello everyone, my name is Trevor, I go by TheMrTrails, and welcome to the channel. In today's video, we'll be going over the best way to farm resources for Tonics in Dauntless Reforged. Farming for Tonic resources got a whole lot easier in Dauntless Reforged, as you'll see in this video. When you're out hunting behemoths, it may not be so easy to tell, but when you're looking for plants, you're gonna find plants. Consider leaving a like if you enjoy, and consider subscribing for more Dauntless content like this. So in Dauntless Reforged, the way plants spawn on the maps has been changed. Each map will have certain resources listed as common, uncommon, or rare. Whereas before, each map would have a couple bonus spawns for materials depending on the biome type, but almost every map would have the same amount of resources. So under this new system, we will naturally gain more of a particular resource found on the islands if that resource is listed as a common spawn on that island. The resources that we need to craft things hasn't changed, so we'll want to come up with a route that optimizes gathering these resources. The items used in the meta for crafting are typically Aetherdrive Tonic, Assault Tonic, Blitz Tonic, Frenzy Tonic, Insight Tonic, and Inspiring Pylon. This means one of our items needs Phoenix Opal, one of our items needs Sky Bloom, one of our items needs Omnistone, two of our items need Slayer's Boon, two of our items need Dash Leaf, and five of our six items here need Wrathwort. However, islands no longer have every resource on them, so we'll want to be bouncing between a few islands to get everything we need for our consumable loadouts. Since Wrathwort is going to be our biggest priority, we're going to want to be on the islands that have Wrathwort listed as a common resource. So our base farming route is going to begin with Underfall Defile and Twilight Sanctuary. On Underfall Defile, we'll have access to Wrathwort, Dashleaf, and Phoenix Opal from our shopping list, and on Twilight Sanctuary, we'll get Wrathwort, Skybloom, and Phoenix Opal. If your consumables loadout you need is Blitz, Frenzy, and Aetherdrive Tonics, these are going to be the only two islands you need to farm on. Similarly, if you just need Wrathworts, then these two islands are going to be what you want to farm on, because these are the only islands that have Wrathwort listed as a common resource. The reason we're going to want to bounce between two islands when we're farming is to ensure that we queue onto a new island. While you can queue up for the same island while already running on that island, this will only work if there's a separate instance of that island already running that has space for you. In the case of Underfall Defile and Twilight Sanctuary, they are also the same map layout, so it's rather easy to remember where all of these spawns to grab are. If instead of the Aetherdrive Tonic you need the Insight or Assault Tonic, you'll want to add the Razorcliff Isle into your rotation, replacing Twilight Sanctuary. Here you'll get Slayer's Boon as well as Skybloom and Dashleaf, meaning a rotation between Razorcliff Isle and Underfall Defile will be the most efficient for that loadout of consumables. And if you need the Inspiring Pylon as your third consumable, Hades Reach will give you a common drop of Omnistone as well as Skybloom and Phoenix Opal at uncommon. So between Underfall Defile and Hades Reach, you'll get everything you need for Blitz and Frenzy Tonics and Inspiring Pylons. So now that we've decided on a route for some specific meta loadouts, what would be a good route if we just want every resource? We can just combine these routes together, so we'll go Underfall Defile, Hades Reach, and Razorcliff Isle. Between these three islands, we'll have every resource available to us at least one time. Now that we know what islands we'll be doing our farming on, what's going to be the build we're farming with? Previously, farming builds needed to have something to help with fighting the behemoths, whereas now that is not the case. You can enter and exit islands all you want, all the time gaining the resources you're collecting without having to fight a behemoth. So we'll be wanting to stack up a bit of move speed, having no need for combat perks. Now, you can stack up more move speed than the build I'm about to show you by using repeaters, but move speed does have an aspect of diminishing returns to it. So the time that it takes to fire off 6 shots to get the effect of lightweight frame, it actually ends up just about even by using chain blades instead. Additionally, at some points in the routes already, we're already moving too fast for our own benefit. So for our weapon, we're going to use any legendary chain blades, whether it be Thrax, Torg, Malkarion, or Agoris. For the time being, I would recommend Thrax, because under certain circumstances, you might be able to use it for some platforming on a route. But once Frost Escalation releases, I would recommend using the Boreas Bonded chain blades for the extra conditioning. Our cells in the legendary weapons are going to be Grace and Swift. All of the bonds on any of these weapons have to deal with combat, so they don't matter. The mod and special don't really matter either. The helmet will be a Malkarion helmet with Sprinter inside. The chest piece can be Embermane, Stormclaw, Scrave, Shrike, Again, all of these have combat-related perks, so which one of these does not matter. All that matters is that you have a sprinter cell inside of your chest piece. For gloves, we'll go with Karabak with fleet-footed inside, and for legs, we'll go with Rezakiri with agility inside. And for the lantern, we'll go with Shrike with zeal inside. So the main parts of our build are 6 grace, 6 sprinter, 6 swift, 3 agility, 3 conditioning, 3 fleet-footed, and 3 zeal. But we'll have to talk about how to use this build exactly, because it will be very easy to misuse it. Grace, sprinter, and swift will give you enough movement speed to be faster than a glider over flat ground. You want to sprint unless you're in a location that will let you fly downward. But even then, sometimes it will be faster to just fall down where you need to go. Conditioning is here for extra stamina for successive gliding should you need it. Fleet-footed is only there to assist you if you lose your stacks of grace. If you stop sprinting for some reason, say you get stuck on a rock, performing a dodge will help you get back to speed. But you don't want to be spamming the dodge. Dodging resets the move speed you would gain from grace as well as your move speed in general. Having this move speed reset is the reason we are not using 6 fleet-footed, even though we could gain more temporary move speed, it ends up being slower. Shrike Lantern with Zeal is only here for when you're running past a behemoth. Currently in the hunting grounds, you're locked out of your lantern abilities unless you enter a combat area. So if behemoths are in the right spot, you'll gain some extra move speed. Now let's talk about the Slayer's Path nodes that will help for farming. Reforging Repeaters will give you 7.5% move speed on all weapons after you reforge 10 times. Then at Milestone 9, the Herbalist and Prospector perks give you a maximum of 25% chance to gather extra herbs or ore. I'd recommend upgrading your Herbalist if you can, but since the Prospector only affects 2 of the 8 ingredients, you can leave that one unfinished until you've spent your exploration merits elsewhere. Additionally, the second node of each consumable on the Slayer's Path will give you a 25% chance to craft those consumables an additional time. Currently, the way this works is it will just double your inputted crafting desire. So, if you want to make 10 of something, you have a 25% chance to actually make 20 of it instead, meaning you should only really try to make consumables in sets of 10 when you have that consumables extra crafting node. Because of this, each node that you get for these double chances will mean that you have less farming to do. Alright, with all that out of the way, let's get on to my testing results of these routes. So I tested the Undervault Defile and Twilight Sanctuary route twice, the first time grabbing almost every resource spawn available, and the other one optimizing the route specifically for Wrathworts. I also tested the Undervault Defile and Razorcliff Isle route, the Undervault Defile and Hades Reach route, and the Undervault Defile, Hades Reach, and Razorcliff Isle route. Each of these tests was for 30 minutes of running between the islands for the route. On my Slayer's Path, I have Herbalist maxed out and Prospector at level 4, meaning some of the items I received dropped double. Before heading into the test, I recorded the exact number of each of the resources on the islands that I had before the test and the exact number that I had after the test. The timer started when pressing start on the first island in rotation, and the timer stopped when 30 minutes were up. Think of this as just a benchmark of sorts, and not the exact results you should expect every single time, but a user occurrence to help give you a rough estimate of what you could get. Running Route 1, Undervault and Sanctuary, in 30 minutes I gained 350 Wrathwort, 107 Dashleaf, 122 Heartlily, 38 Iron Thistle, 70 Phoenix Opal, and 119 Skybloom. As mentioned, I decided to run this route again, this time going for specifically optimizing Wrathworts, since it's the most desirable of the crafting resources. If there are extra ingredients on my way through the route, I grabbed them, but I didn't make any detours unless they were specifically mushroom related. A high volume of Wrathwort route, if you will. This cut down the average time I spent on the island from 5 minutes to 3 minutes, which means I was able to get into 4 more instances in the same amount of time. Think of this route as an estimate if you're going for a specific resource that is common on both islands in a 2-island rotation. I was able to pick up 536 Wrathwort in the 30 minutes, still grabbing 61 of each Dashleaf and Skybloom while I was at it. This yielded nearly 18 mushrooms per minute, more than 4 times better than the rate Terra Patrols used to provide. You could do this same thing with other resources as well if you were particularly low on one resource. For Dashleaf, you can bounce between Cape Fury and Brightwood. For Skybloom, it would be Razorcliff Isle and the Snowblind Waste. And for Phoenix Opal, it would be Restless Sands and Frostmarch. For Phoenix Opal though, you'd experience less efficiency due to having to hold Interact to pick it up. Next up was our Undervault Defile and Razorcliff Isle route. Here I grabbed 180 Wrathwort, 189 Dashleaf, 104 Heartlily, 28 Iron Thistle, 48 Phoenix Opal, 104 142 Skybloom and 142 Slayer's Boon. For Underval Defile and Hades Reach run-throughs, you'll take significantly longer per run than other islands, since stones are the main resources at Hades Reach. With this route, I got 162 Wrathwort, 117 Dashleaf, 63 Heart Lily, 55 Iron Thistle, 116 Phoenix Opal, 86 Skybloom, and 97 Omnistone. And finally, for a gathering of all resources route through Underval Defile, Hades Reach, and Razorcliff Isle, I was able to grab 112 Wrathwort, 141 Dashleaf, 67 Heart Lily, 36 Iron Thistle, 91 Phoenix Opal, 151 Skybloom, 86 Omnistone, and 93 Slayer's Boon. So there's the data I've collected for you guys on the farming of materials for several different farming routes. The efficiency of the farming is going to be solely determined by what you yourself need to grab. Honestly, it might just be best to farm for what you need when you need it. Grabbing around 1,000 of a specific resource each hour is a really fast rate in comparison to what we had previously, and still being able to grab a couple hundred of some other resources while you're at it is pretty nice as well. If you have a mostly even amount of resources, I like the Underwald and Razorcliff Isle route, as it has a fairly balanced dose of Wrathwort, Dashleaf, Skybloom, and Slayer's Boon, and it still has some Phoenix Opal spawns that you can pick up along the way. Naturally, you can improve any of the rates on any of the routes that I took if you wanted to prioritize on a selected few resources, but at that point you should consider the single resource at a time farming method. Well, that'll get us to the end of the video. Just a quick note for anyone wondering, my Dauntless Partner Flare is currently in design and is looking mighty fine. Many of you guys may know that I'm a Rowlet fan, and we're trying to do a full faith sort of fusion between Shroud and Rowlet for the Flare, and we're taking our time on it, as rushing it out before it's pristine wouldn't be the right call. But if you enjoyed the video or learned anything, consider leaving a like, and if you enjoy Dauntless content and you are not subscribed already, consider subscribing to the channel where I post Dauntless content every week. I've been Trevor, I go by the Mr. Trails, and I will catch you guys next time.